Welcome to Beyond Focus. I'm your host, Coach Lynn, sitting in for Angie Daniels. We have a very special show for you today with Dr. Pollard of the Colon and Rectal Services of the Queens Medical Center, talking about colon cancer and coming up with some real solutions how we could get it out of our family and our community once and for all. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after these messages. You're watching Beyond Focus. Welcome back to the show. We're joined now by a good friend, Dr. David Lee, from the SUNY Downstate Medical Center, as well as the Kings County Health Center. Doc, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on the show.
Welcome to the show, anytime. Doc, we were earlier talking about the African-American community and preventive methods. Doc clearly set the tone for the problem. What have you seen? You're right in the heat of the battle, particularly for those who are waiting till the last minute. Has that been the case?
Yes, definitely. And I think I applaud you for having a show like this, because I think education is probably the biggest key in trying to improve our screening guidelines. I'm sure you mentioned it before. I wasn't here before, but when a patient comes to us and they have these other symptoms like change in bowel habits, weight loss, or blood in their poop, that means we've gotten to the point where it's beyond to the point where we can take it out and prevent them from getting colon cancer. And that's one of the risks that we want to try to get patients to get it, even though they feel okay in trying to get these colonoscopies done at the right screening age, in order to prevent them from getting advanced disease later on.
Right. It's too, at that point, it's not good.
Yeah.
Bottom line.
I like to tell my patients, like, it's sort of like a pimple on the skin. You know, you might not feel it, you can see it a little bit, but you can't see the colon on the inside. So until it grows into something big and bursts, that's the only time that you're going to have symptoms. And it might be too late when you have symptoms.
Very
and that's
true.
The unfortunate part that we see a lot of, I'm sure at Elmer's Hospital, but definitely at Kings County Hospital.
Doctor, as well as you being at both of those two renowned facilities, I'm sure you see on a daily basis those that are coming in regarding this terrible disease. Over the past few years, have you seen an influx in the numbers of people coming in with colon cancer?
Yes, definitely. I would say a majority of the ones that we do screenings on are just asymptomatic, meaning patients that don't have symptoms. A high majority of them have colon cancer, and this is consistent with the studies they did down in D.C., and that's why with the American College of Gastroenterology and the American Gastroenterology Association, we do have guidelines that say that at a younger age to screen, especially African-American males, and because they're very much at increased risk for cancer. And I've seen a lot of unfortunate cases when they're younger. The good part is that we have better modalities to get rid of these polyps. We have better ways of treating these patients. We have better surgeons, especially like Dr. Pollard, who specializes in colorectal surgery.
Right.
And so it's a lot better than what we have had before, and we have better medications. So out of all the cancers, the best part is that we know the progression of cancer in colon cancer. So we know how to find it early and to prevent patients from having late complications.
The reluctance, we were talking earlier about the reluctance of so many to at least even start the ball rolling, at least get the initial tests. Have you had that as far as a lot of the people you've seen were just so fearful?
Definitely. I think it's partly because of education, maybe partly because of what they've seen on the news. And I understand it. Everyone is always afraid about going for a colonoscopy, but it's not specifically like surgery. Most people, I tell them that the worst part of the colonoscopy is actually the prep, the day before when you have to clean out your bowels. I think that's the worst part of the whole test. Most patients say when they have it and they're done, they're surprised at how quickly it's done.
Nice.
They're surprised that they, because pretty much they wake up and they're like, oh my goodness. I would say a majority of my patients say, what happened? I thought, when are you going to start the test? And they don't even realize that the test is already over.
Yes. Doc, it's been said on many fronts, today in particular, taking care of yourself. There's lots of things that you could be doing now that can curb whether you get this dreaded disease or not. What have you seen over your course of your history of things that the people can be doing now?
To prevent colon
exactly.
cancer specific? Well, first of all, is also seeing getting good care with your doctor. So the first off is, if unless we can catch it early, get rid of these polyps or these bumps and formations before they form cancer, that's step number one, by far the most. But other things is to reduce your risk factors. So we know that any type of cancer is linked to obesity and diabetes. So trying to reduce those risk factors would help. High fiber diet has also been associated with lower risks of cancer. And there's new data out there also on certain things like medications, over-the-counter medications, but those really haven't panned out yet. So there's a lot of research in trying to figure out what we can do to reduce the risk of colon cancer.
We keep talking about obesity. We've mentioned that two or three times now. Wow, what's going on with us? How is that correlation between the two?
That, I'm sure that's, that is the $64,000 question.
Exactly. If we knew that, someone would be very rich.
But there's definitely some, those two are linked together.
Yes.
If you're not watching your weight, if you're not watching what you're eating well, you are more susceptible to possibly having that polyp.
Yeah, not only that, also other types of cancers. So we know that obesity itself.
Look at that.
Yes, especially in breast cancer, for example, in postmenopausal women, because a lot of the estrogen comes from the fat cells that you have in excess of. But for colon cancer, I don't think that people know the correlation yet.
Yeah. Look at that. Well, we're so thankful, Doc. We're appreciative of that you're here. Both of you two, we want to once again say thank you and congratulate you on the wonderful work you guys are doing. It's most needed. We encourage you to come back to the show many times because this conversation continues. Until such time as it's done, we'll keep on fighting. I know you two are soldiers in the battle.
Definitely.
Thank you for having us.
We'll be right back after these messages. You're watching Beyond Focus. Welcome back to the show. Doctors, if you could, please, give us one word of advice for our viewers today of how they can beat this monster, if you will. Doc?
Well, like we said before, I think the most important thing is if you're at the age of 45 and you're African-American, definitely go see your doctor immediately about getting a colonoscopy. And I like to tell my patients, the good part is if you get it then and you have no family history of colon cancer, then the next test we wouldn't have to repeat for 7 to 10 years.
Male or female?
Male or female.
Well, I echo Dr. Lee's recommendation. I think, you know, in the African-American community, we do have a responsibility to our family. And not only we do it for ourselves because we want to stay healthy and live a long life, but we are also have people that depend on us, that we are responsible for, called children. We certainly want to be there for them. And if we keep our health and we do all those preventive steps, whether we have to lose some weight, do some exercise, change our diet a little bit, and go to the doctor and be checked. We need to be screened. And as Dr. Lee says, for African American, age 45, you start. And that's the best advice you could have.
Thank you, guys. Doc, I couldn't say it any better. You heard it straight from the source. There's no excuses. Get yourself checked, start taking care of yourselves, and take care of your families. Welcome to Beyond Focus. I'm your host, Coach Lynn, sitting in for Ms. Daniels. Today we have three special guests talking about some issues and some concerns in our community with our health that have to be addressed today. We have a talented trio here today talking about our health, our family's health, our personal health in the community from HANA, one of the most renowned and prolific organizations in the country, the Haitian American Nurses Association, correct?
Yes.
That's right?
Yes.
I got it right?
Yes.
That's right. Okay. The three lovely young ladies, I'll introduce them to you, but we're going to be talking today about breast cancer, diabetes, and hypertension, the silent killer. Welcome, ladies, to Beyond Focus. We're so honored that you're here with us today.
Thank you.
Maria, if you don't mind, I want to talk to you first. Ms. Boyer, a wonderful registered nurse, about breast cancer. We just recently got through with Breast Cancer Month, celebrating those who survived it, but it's not easy. Tell us, what is breast cancer? What is that?
Essentially, it's a malformation in the tissues of the cells, the breast cells. So you can have various aspects. Women, as early as the age of 16, once you start menstruating, should really start examining themselves right after their menstrual cycle to see if there's any abnormality in the breast tissue. Once you identify that there is an abnormality, whether it's a lump, whether you feel that it's not equally on both breasts, you should follow up with your primary physician to have mammographies and further examinations. Now, in particular for the black population, black female population, it's 1 out of 2 that are diagnosed with any type of abnormality winds up being cancer. For a woman in particular, early screening and early detection is the key. You have to examine yourself early, identify early, and then do the appropriate follow-up that needs to be done. Women that are under the age of 30, if you are at high risk, you should have your mammography minimally annually. Mm-hmm. And women that are 40 and above, you should have your mammography just like you have your regular examinations every year. That would include your annual mammography or breast sonogram if they identify anything. But on a monthly basis, all women from the age of 16 and above should be examining their breasts monthly.
Wonderful. Excellent advice from 16 and up, something probably that's not said as much. That's the first time I heard that. And we were talking earlier about my daughter getting checked. She's on her way right now. Beautiful.
Why the cancer, menstruating?
The actual cancer part, and it seems so devastating, particularly for women who catch it too late. When is it time to catch it so that it won't be devastating to them, so it won't kill them?
Once you identify an abnormality in your self-breast examination, which should be done every month, and most doctors can teach you how to self-examine yourself, do the self-breast examination. Once you identify it, you have to go get tested. Testing is very simple. When I identified a lump in my breast, my doctor did a biopsy in his office. So that was as easy as that.
Right.
And follow-ups were done, you know, with breast specialists, but you can certainly have the preliminary biopsy done. If once they do the biopsy, it could be benign or malignant, and that's where women that are not tested and maybe identify a lump and don't follow up appropriately, and when they do start having pain or symptoms of cancer is when they go and get tested, and at that time it's too late.
Wow.
Perhaps the cancer had already spread to certain tissues. If you identify early, it could be simple as doing what they call a lumpectomy, which is a remove of part of the breast. If you wait too late, it could spread where they have to have a total removal.
So it seems like even with the other diseases we've talked to throughout the show, and has really been prevalent on that. Mm-hmm. Early detection is key for how we're going to go with this.
Yes.
It doesn't have to be necessarily devastating.
Yes.
But if you don't catch it in time, it's tougher to fight.
Absolutely.
Wonderful.
Absolutely.
Greta, the same thing we were talking earlier about diabetes. Wow, I can't wait to get into this one.
Hi.
Ooh-wee.
Well, hi. Once before I start, I must say thank you so much for Beyond Focus. Give us the opportunity, we Anna, to reach out to the community. Again, the key, like you said, the key of healthcare is, beside the clinical aspect, is communication, to know how you're gonna talk to your doctor, to express yourself. Mm. It is really devastating that diabetes become the seventh leading cause of death in United States. What even make it even worse? Most of people do not know that they have diabetes.
They don't even know they have the diabetes before it's too late?
They don't even know, okay? And I must add, the Caribbean community, we are part of the 12.6% of the non-Hispanic black suffering of diabetes.
Look at that.
And diabetes gives you all other problems. The high blood pressure, and you have so many complications with diabetes. This is why, as a nurse, as a healthcare part of the healthcare, I strongly, strongly suggest that we need to learn how to speak. How, just like you do in communication, reach out to the community, we need to know how to speak to our provider.
That's right.
By doing that, by asking questions, we're going to know what it is.
That's right.
And then you need to take part. You not to be afraid. The more you know, the more you're going to manage your care.
That's right.
And you can pay a doctor $1 million, but if you as a patient, you don't know what's going on, how are you going to help yourself? So it is very important. Diabetes is a killer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what is diabetes? We don't know. Your patients say, "Oh yeah, I'm diabetic," but what it is? Or I know it's sugar, but right. But they have different type of diabetes. What's going on? What should we do?
Right.
Those are the questions that we need to ask. The community must not be afraid.
That's right.
To ask what it's all about.
That's right.
And it's very important. Okay, to communicate. The key component is communication. What is diabetes? Diabetes is really, like we said, we know it's elevated blood sugar. But what is the cause of it? What's happening? We know in our body there is a little hormone called insulin. Okay, and this hormone is being produced by a special cells that God gave us in our body called beta cells. And this is the only cell that produces this hormone. What does it do? It balance the sugar. And we know when we eat, the end products of our nutrition become sugar.
Right.
So now, if you don't have this hormone to balance your sugar, what's going to happen? It stay within your blood. By staying in your blood vessels, what is going to make, of course, it's going to be too much. We have to balance. So the fact that there's an increase of blood sugar within your blood, you're going to defect your blood vessels, and here you are, high blood pressures. You're going to defect your body, here you are, kidney problems. You're going to defect every part of your body because it's a system. Our body is a system. Everything is connected. Okay? So when the blood glucose is elevated, so now you're having problem with your eyes, you're having so many complications.
Right.
So again, the key component, as you identify, we must communicate, we must detect early. How are we going to detect diabetes early? Again, there are some signs and symptoms that we have to be aware. And we know if you see that you go into the bathroom a lot, to urinate a lot, it's very important. That means something is happening. Okay, if when I eat, I'm always hungry. What's going on? Okay, and when I'm nervous, what's going on? I'm always reaching out for food. Okay, and I'm sweating. Your body is not it's balanced.
It's telling you something.
Yes, it's telling you something. Right. And remember, you see your gut feeling. Whenever you have that gut feeling, I'm not okay, reach out for help.
That's so true. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I like that.
Yes.
And both of those two are getting ready to come right into that silent killer.
Yes.
Hypertension or hyper blood pressure. Mm-hmm. Michelle, we're going to jump into that bad boy as soon as we come back from commercial, all right?
Great.
I know you got your boxing gloves on. This is not deal.
Yes.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Beyond Focus right after these messages. Welcome back to Beyond Focus. We're here now with the talented trio from H.A.N.A, one of the most renowned organizations in the country dealing with issues that others won't touch, our family's health. Michelle, we were talking to your teammates earlier about those two devastating factors.
Yes.
Wow, but you got the bad one coming up, correct?
Yes.
Hypertension, what is that?
Hypertension. Many of us refer to it as high blood pressure.
High blood pressure.
And it's a common condition in the United States, and it affects 65 million Americans. It's more common in the African population, where it's 40% in our community. It is also referred to as a silent killer. Many people can walk around with it for years and not even know about it, that they have it. There's no obvious signs. When signs are apparent, and these may include headaches, severe headaches, nosebleeds, severe anxiety. It's at that case, that patient or that individual is at the hypertensive crisis.
When you say they don't know they have it, is that just to simply the high blood pressure test, that's the only thing that they have to do is get that to be able to tell?
Well, yes.
That simple test, that's all they need to have and they can tell.
Well, before doctors can diagnose you with high pressure is the increased force of the blood against your blood vessels. the doctor would have to, he or she then will take your blood pressure two or three times in two different instances, different appointments, and then diagnose you then with high blood pressure.
Got you. We would have forgot to be told. How does the high blood pressure relate to the other two, particularly breast cancer? It all seems one body. One body. And like you said before, it's telling you something's going on. Have you seen anything, a correlation between the two?
No, not in particularly. There haven't been studies that correlate the two. Generally, you might have patients that have breast cancer and they have may be taking certain medications that predispose them to hypertension or other factors. Mm-hmm. You know, they might have what they call comorbidity. They have other diagnoses in addition to the breast cancer, you know, lump in the breast. It could be diabetes or it could be hypertension. And that makes it a little more complicated for the physician to treat the patient at that time because he's not only focusing on the breast issue, but also on other medical issues that he needs to treat.
On both your two, and I'm going to come back to the diabetes to try to shore this up. We've heard a lot about losing weight, watching your diet, those types of things. As diabetes is the base, we know it has to clear that one up. Yes. But have you seen it also helps in the other two?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All three of those, one in particular. What this losing weight thing, we hear it so much, they're not getting it, clearly.
Staying healthy.
It's staying healthy.
It's staying healthy.
It's prevention. It's prevention. And I'm so excited that Mrs. Obama, that is her initiative.
That's
that
right.
We as Americans need to lose weight, and it starts first with our children. They say in a bottle of soda, a child can ingest how many pounds of sugar?
A lot. I saw that
in
on
a
the
sitting.
News.
Exactly. It's in addition with losing weight. It's also with quitting quit smoking.
Right. Good one.
Limit the intake of alcohol. Alcohol is good to an extent, but in moderation. Everything in moderation.
Correct. Diabetes too, I know on that.
Yes, I may echo Michelle, because when you look at diabetes, and at first, when they used to do studies, diabetes used to be genetic. If your parents have diabetes, you prone to have diabetes. However, the encounter nowadays, because of weight gain, because of lifestyle, people become diabetic. And this is, like she said, you have by choice. It's just like you become, you predisposing yourself by your health, like about a lifestyle. You eat too much, okay, you're gaining weight. Remember, like, again, it's a system. If you gain weight, your heart's gonna not pump, it's not enough to pump the blood in your body. You're gonna have blood pressures. Of course, by having blood pressure, your kidney is gonna be affected.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're gonna have sugar. Then all of these things, all of these conditions will impede your lifestyle, will impede your health.
That's right.
So this is why exercise, healthy diet,
right?
Okay, and prevention, they work together.
That's right.
Okay,
right.
By doing this, you really have to take ownership of your health. And this is a good promotion that you must know. Because diabetes, it is what you eat. Look at we Haitians, look at what's happening. We eat a lot of sugar. A lot of rice, a lot of starch. And there is right now, it's amazing, Boston Medical Center is doing a research on the Haitian diet. And what's happening to us? What's happening because of rice? We love rice. Breads, and we're having type 2 diabetes. And they say, because we don't talk to our patients, to our providers on time to know what's going on, and it's escalated to the type that is beyond.
Wow.
And we're having an issue, okay? Mm-hmm. And we need to know the markers, certain questions. What's going on with my body? They have so many studies with diabetes. There's something called A1C markers that you do, the doctors need to do, okay, at least 3 or 4 times a year. And that's when now they can categorize certain people. Are you pre-diabetic? because you might not have diabetes, mm-hmm. but the A1C, because the Diabetics Association said if your A1C is 7 and above, you are prone to be diabetic. Mm-hmm. So all this question, you might not be that, hey, doctors, can you check my A1C? Okay, at a certain age, because my parents had it. So I wanna, so take ownership and ask questions and wonderful. Communicate. And that will really put you in a place that you know,
that's right.
that you know what your health is all about.
That's right.
Okay.
And, then with breast cancer, it has to be almost the same thing. Checking,
right.
talking, asking early, questions, quick.
Right, early detection, especially women that are on birth controls. Pills, you know, there's done many studies that show a correlation between the birth control pill and developing breast cancer. So women, as early as the time that you start taking birth control pills, you should certainly be doing your mammographies, doing your breast self-examination, and even go beyond. There's different levels that you could go and do some breast sonogram as well. And as you know, we're talking about staying healthy in general. You know, you're trying to eat well. You're trying to avoid the excess sugars and the mm-hmm. excess starches and excess sodium that's in your content. But look at your medicine cabinet. What else you're taking that can cause be detrimental to your health?
That's true.
Not the medicine cabinet. Don't open that one up. All kind of stuff can fall out, huh? Right. You forget even what you had in there. Right. You're just taking it. Right. We don't like it. Right. Hypertension and high blood pressure. Parents yes. having it. If my mother had high blood yes. pressure, does that make me more prone
does
to have it?
Does increase your predisposition of having, hypertension as well. There's environmental factors, things that we can change about ourselves, but other things that we cannot, like the familial tendencies of having hypertension, your sex. Your gender, rather. Men are more likely to have to acquire hypertension.
Really?
Yes, and in race, of course, as I mentioned earlier. And the African-American population, it's more likely that we can have hypertension as well.
Well, my friends, that's it for another edition of Beyond Focus. On behalf of Ms. Daniels, who's going to be with you again next week, and our prayers go out to her and her family, we want to say thank you. And we hope that the information that you got today won't just pass you by. You'll take heed to it and go see your doctor and prevent all these things from happening to you, because we want to see you for a long time. All right? So once again, we'll see you next week. I'm Coach Lynn. Have a beautiful day.